First of all, if you do nothing else, in my opinion, from this day, and certainly these presentations, play back David's speech. Seriously, amazing advice. Really, really, no joke. I mean, I'm going to play back that speech, and I'm going to play it for the entire community at Mattel, because step by step, every single piece of advice you just got is going to be the answer to whatever it is that you're trying to do in the context of potential breakthroughs. Really, I feel like I should wrap it up right here, because honestly, after that, it is a little difficult, because the advice and the success is really impressive, and clearly what's even more impressive is talking backwards, which I've never seen or heard of in my entire life. So that was one I'm going to remember. The other one that I just typed out, which is one of the sort of funny parts about, I think, this industry, and particularly at Mattel, because, you know, obviously we're a big company, we're a public company, we're very serious, we speak to investors all the time. But I would love to have the next conversation with investors include things like Bongo Congo and Rattle Me Bones and various different names of toys that you just can't not smile at, right? And these people don't smile, okay? So it would be really, really great to have that as part of our mix. So what am I going to do for you today that you haven't already gotten that's really tangible and takeaway? I'm going to give you an update about Mattel. And you all know Mattel, right? I mean, first of all, how many people have worked at Mattel? Not bad. Where's Gary Swisher? Gary Swisher from Mattel. Just saying. We love Gary. We love Spin, but just saying. How many people have sold a product, an invention, a mechanism, more hands? Not as much hands as I want. Hopefully by the end of this, there'll be a lot more hands, all right? But ultimately, I think what you all know is Mattel is a storied toy company. So what I want to talk about a little bit is not only Mattel and where we're at and how we sort of got to where we got to, but also just recognizing that toys as an industry is an industry that's been around for hundreds of years. This is not a new gig, right? I mean, in the context of the here and now, of course, we're inventing the new. But we operate, we work, we create in an industry that's almost part of human nature. Play has always been around. I mean, this doll, arguably, could be the original doll. It's from the first century, right? And it was put together and created and inspired some child somewhere in the first century around all the possibilities of either what he or she could be, or her best friend, or his best friend, or some sort of obviously really emotional connection to what today is, of course, a toy. Mattel started in 1945, so ultimately kind of one of the defining companies of the modern toy era. And 75 years later, we're still going and we're still strong, but the foundation of what Mattel is becoming, in my opinion, one of the most important attributes of what keeps the company going. So I don't invent, right? I actually, you know, I'm a frustrated creative because I don't do art, I don't do music, you'll hear a lot more about that. I actually kind of do nothing, but in the context of what I do, it's study brands, study companies, see products, see creative, and figure out how to make them relevant for today. Because in the context of works, what works today is what's relevant, what speaks to somebody. So the origin story of Mattel is something that I really take a lot of pride in and a lot of time in understanding, because whatever happened back then is the foundation that we continue to live off of. So understanding what made a company great in the first place can be the unlock potential of what keeps a company going. So how did Mattel start? What was the origin story? The origin story of Mattel is it started with invention. It was inventors that started Mattel. And in the context of what our inventors originally started to work on, mixed material, acrylics, they were making acrylic jewelry, Lucite doll furniture. Our founders, Ruth, Elliot, and Matt, were essentially an invention team. That's how the gig started. Now, at the time that it started, which is also really important to know, when you're doing what you're doing, we live in a world where a lot of things are happening. So how do you think about the world that you're living in, the consumers that you're trying to appeal to, pop culture, and figure out, is there a connection between what I'm trying to make and what's happening in the world? So what was happening in the world back when our company started was, it was pretty exciting. It was post-war, it was California, Disneyland had just opened, the Beach Boys were rocking. I mean, things were kind of terrific. It was a happy time in the context of what was happening in the world. And there was a lot more modernity that was happening and invention, but toys was sort of sleepy at the time. This was the baby doll of its moment, and this was a die-cast toy car. It wasn't necessarily a reflection of what was happening in the world that we were living in at that time. One of the aspects, and I think one of the contexts of conversations happened, whose daughter named a product? There's a moment here where her daughter named a product, right? One of the things I love about our industry, our history, and in the context of what you get inspiration from, a lot of it is around your kids. A lot of it is around that emotional connection with your kids. There's sort of an aha moment of how can I take what's happening and create some commercial commerce idea out of it. Well, Ruth watched her daughter, Barbara, play with paper dolls. And at the time, of course, Barbara had a baby doll, but she really loved playing with paper dolls. And in the paper doll moment, she saw that it was more fashion-oriented, and the conversations around paper dolls were about all these different aspects of imagination of what she could be. And in that magical moment, she was inspired to create the Barbie doll, a doll that inspires limitless potential in every girl. That's the foundation of a brand that 60 years later, 8 quarters of double-digit growth, by the way, just saying, is an amazing invention at a time where you look at what was happening in the world, you looked at what your daughter or child was playing with, you put it together in the context, and you brought out something that was breakthrough. It wasn't necessarily received so well right away, by the way. In the context of history, if you look at the history, Ruth and Elliot at Toy Fair, hawking this doll, it didn't go really well. Okay, people were sort of shocked at the context of this adult-like figure. And so part of the push on this was, how do we get this in front of communities and people that start to be inspired by what this doll represents and actually sell it? Another important part of Mattel's heritage was not only the bold risk of creating products that were breakthrough products, but how to communicate your product at that particular time. Anybody know who this guy is in the middle?
Walt Disney.
The two people on the side, Ruth and Elliot. Okay, Walt did a lot better in the context of history. Just saying on that one too. We're doing all right, but clearly Walt did quite a breakthrough job. Southern California entrepreneurs, good friends, Ruth and Elliot put almost their entire budget, even more so, on the line to create a Barbie television commercial on the Mickey Mouse Club, which essentially revolutionized, certainly Mattel, and it was a breakthrough moment of taking a shot at a communication vehicle that they didn't know. There were no GRPs, no data, no insights, nobody telling you exactly what's gonna happen, when it's gonna happen by the minute. There were no data scientists. It was just, we got to get into that space. We're going to take the leap. We're going to put it all on the line. And then we're going to arguably hope that this works. And clearly, you know the history in the context of what happened. Now, Barbie's one story, but we have other amazing stories that relate, again, to what was happening in the world and ultimately what was invented at the same time. So Hot Wheels is a storied, obviously, brand for us as well. Toy cars at that time didn't reflect what was happening that kids see. As I showed you the picture in the context of what was diecast at the time, but what people were seeing at the time were these souped up, amazing looking design cars. And Elliot realized by creating something that was aspirational, that was hot, that was mobile, that could move, that was fast, that was furious, that was exciting, he could create what became Hot Wheels. Combined with an inventor who was a rocket scientist. You'd think a rocket scientist combined with our inventor created in 1968 the breakthrough product that we all know today, 50 years later, and 51 years today is going to have the biggest year it's ever had. Those are obviously storied brands, you all know them. There are thousands of other stories within Mattel that never made it. And it wasn't without trying. I mean, this was one of the classic ones that I just pulled up. Bubble O'Bill Bubble Hat. It was a total bubble bomb. And it was a storied moment, but I use it in the context of our history because the history of the company is not necessarily just about hits. It's about trials. It's about going through a lot of different ideas all the time and seeing what exactly is going to work. And sometimes you just don't know. So you gotta take shots. That's the only way that we're gonna have those breakthroughs. The most successful inventions become something far more valuable. Now, what I mean by that in the context of our storied history is once you reach a certain point with a product that graduates into a brand, they cross over into multi-generational brands. That's when you're really starting to not only ring the register, by the way, but have a foundation for continuity and continued success. There are not many of these type brands that exist, but the ones that exist are incredibly powerful. And the interesting part of them is when you go back to the origins and you understand that to keep them great, that's the interesting secret sauce, if you will, that I'm going to share a little bit more with you about. I believe a key ingredient for turning inventions into brands is actually purpose. Purpose really does matter. And what I reference when you're inspired by your kids, there's a purposeful moment going on. Something's going on that that kid is enjoying, is doing, is sparking, his imagination is inspired, and you're inspired by it. Something purposeful is happening. Now, purpose is an interesting conversation. Multi-generational brands must be reinvented to stay relevant, right? When I talk about Barbie at 50, 60, Hot Wheels at 51, Fisher-Price at 90. 90. 8-Ball, Uno, a lot of brands that we have that are really stand the test of time. How do they do that? They continuously reinvent themselves off of what they were to stay relevant. Today, to stay relevant, you must essentially kind of look at the world around you and see what are the insights happening in pop culture that matter. And today, purpose really matters. Millennial moms and dads are looking at brands that have value statements. They're looking at companies and saying, what do you stand for? It's not just about the product that you sell, it's about what the product means. What is it going to do for the world? What is it going to do for my child? What is it going to do for me? It has to stand for something. Insights and research are showing that two-thirds of millennials and Gen Z prefer brands with a point of view that stand for something. It's an important aspect of understanding in reinvention how to take what exists and try and make it a purposeful statement to appeal to people who are purchasing, and also as you invent, to ultimately use a canvas for pop culture and think about purpose as a way to invent against. So, let's talk about inventing and values for just a few minutes in the context of what I believe are great examples of reinvention and how brands stay relevant using one insight, purpose, as a filter. Uno. How many people know Uno? Okay, better know Uno. It's the single biggest, largest card game in the world. Thank you very much. But how does it stay relevant? It's the same card game. How does it stay relevant? Well, there's a massive amount of work in the context of what Uno is doing to stay relevant and to continue growing. But one of the ones that I wanted to share with you in relation to how does Uno become purposeful, beyond the normal, I play it, I play with my kids, it's really useful on the plane, how does it become more purposeful? And this is a conversation with Ray Adler. Where's Ray? Ray's not here. That's classic. Is that classic? Yeah. Ray. Oh, look at Ray! Look at Ray! Good timing. That's Ray. Good timing, man. Just slips in right on time. That was good. He was in the hallway on the phone. He heard his name. I'm sure. Anyway, just to throw you a bone here, in the context of the pursuit of purpose through Uno, how can you make Uno more purposeful than the base of what it is? Take a look at what that team created.
It's a sighted world, so it's important to have accessibility for the blind, but also to be able to pull out a deck of cards and say, hey, there's Braille and print on this, you want to play? And it'll just be really fun.
Braille is a critical tool for literacy and full participation of the blind in all aspects of society. My name is Mark Riccobono, and I'm president of the National Federation of the Blind.
Well, guess what? Well, now it's your turn again.
No, actually, it's your turn. It puts Braille in all sorts of places where people aren't going to expect it.
I, as a blind teacher, use Braille in my classroom. So for my students, there's always the conversation in the beginning of every year, why do you read books with your hands? And that's a conversation now that can be had anytime somebody opens a box of Uno cards. It's not just like Braille on a wall outside a bathroom, Braille on a wall outside an elevator. It's Uno, it's like right there.
Just being able to go to a store and pick it up and being able to play it right off the shelf, that's an experience that people haven't been able to have. Nothing is available.
Anytime we can find anything that's accessible or adapted, already done and already made, it sounds very, you know, cheesy and simple, but it's the best feeling ever.
It's a game for everybody. Everybody plays Uno.
Uno Braille will be available in-store and online at Target.
It is a great example of how purpose as a pop culture insight translated to a basic game like Uno can really make a meaningful difference. Big kudos to Ray, the design team, for essentially inventing that and reinventing it for today. So nice job, Ray. Another really important reinvention is, of course, what's happened with the Barbie brand. And this is a story brand. I mean, obviously, with 99.9% brand recognition, it is a pop culture icon. It's a canvas for cultural conversation. Like her, don't like her. It's all part of the essential ingredients that make Barbie, Barbie. But how do you keep a brand like Barbie, which is essentially the same 11.5-inch doll it's always been, relevant for today? And in the context of its evolution, the origins from fashion model to role model has been a true reinvention of this brand. And in the context of that, it's been designed and or repurposed as a better reflection of the world that girls see today. One of the insights that we had as Barbie was challenged several years ago was that she wasn't a reflection of what girls were seeing in the world today. And so rather than having what essentially used to be, I call a Mattel monologue, which says, well, Barbie's Barbie, it's a girl, it's for toy, she is what she is the size she is the look she is. Her body is not a conversation because essentially she's a toy. It was a monologue. It wasn't a dialogue. And today's consumer has access to dialogue. The consumer owns the brand. So if you're ignoring what the consumer is telling you, you're actually compromising what could be the future of the brand. So you have to deal with it. So we became more oriented to understanding what does our consumer think and start to make the appropriate changes to keep this brand relevant. And part of that was essentially looking at the canvas that is Barbie and starting to represent her in a more identified way that girls see in the world. 23 new different ethnicities that are featured and prominently featured on merchandising and advertising on shelf and through dolls. We also took the body conversation and brought it in-house and said, you know what? The criticism that we have for Barbie's body is something that we need to start to address. If girls and moms have concerns around it, let's address it. Let's recognize that we need to make some changes to better reflect what girls see. Ethnicity is one of them, but body inclusivity and diversity is another one. We did this by not compromising the original Barbie, but providing choice around her. Short, curvy, tall, and so forth. And the world took notice. We were on the cover of Time magazine as the number one story in the world. Literally, the number one story in the world on the cover of Time magazine, and nearly 100% of the conversation was positive. Now, this is a toy that is on the cover of Time magazine that has impact in the world and creates cultural conversation and changes the world. That potentially is somewhere in this audience today. I believe it. Because it starts here and potentially can get here. Very few industries and context of invention can eventually live up to those standards. Today, we proudly tell you that more than half of the Barbies sold represent diversity. One out of every seven is a wheelchair Barbie. Can you imagine that? It's awesome. It recognizes people and parts of communities that weren't recognized before. Insight into invention. Okay, I'm telling you a brand revitalization story, but hopefully what I'm trying to also thread to you is different ways of thinking, not only about the same brand, but what's happening in the world. Who's recognized, who's not? How does this become more purposeful? All of these things, on top of, by the way, David's amazing advice, becomes more ingredients for you to start to think about. In addition to that, we also set forth role models who were real. So it's one thing to imagine through this doll what you can be, but it's another thing to associate real, aspirational women with their accomplishments. And so we started this whole Shiro campaign, where we honor recognized women around the world with a Barbie doll, inspiring girls to continue to believe that they can be anything. And in the context of that continuity, what we also realized and what we know is there's a problem in the world, right? Now that we're on a roll and we're doing great business and we're doing great things for the world, what more can we do to become even more purposeful and more powerful with this cultural conversation pop icon? Girls today, despite all the things that we know and the breakthroughs that we know, still at age 5, for whatever reason, and we have a lot of insights and research, believe that they can't be everything that a boy can. They don't believe that they have the same opportunities or the same sophistication intelligence that a boy has. Why? We have to solve the issue. It's an issue that we have to address and solve. Our brand's purpose is a direct bullseye to helping solve that issue. So how do we become even more purposeful? We define this epidemic in the world called the dream gap. The difference between girls and boys and that space that we have to identify to continue to inspire them to be anything and equal to whatever a boy can do. We established the dream gap as part of the purposeful conversation of Barbie, and I'll take you through a little video of some of the sort of feel of what we're trying to do. To stand up in a legacy company with brands that you essentially inherit, with founders that unfortunately are not with us today, but to see these brands continue with the team that we have at Mattel, reinventing these brands every day with meaning and purpose, not just commerce, is inspiring work. One of the things, obviously, that we're sharing to you with you today is obviously continuing to reinvent the greatest brands in play is not easy. Sometimes when you see things, they look easy. It's obviously not easy to do this. But we are also continuously creating exciting new ways to play. The feed and the pipeline of new is really, really important to Mattel. We have communities like you that we need more interest and more ideas to understand how to create. And we also have amazing people inside Mattel that create every day. And like I said, in the context of what I'm trying to add value to, again, commercial moment for David's speech, is how do you relate to pop culture? Pop culture is a navigation point and a really important aspect of in what I believe is invention. The latest invention, pop cultural connection, that I believe is a strong statement that Mattel made is Creatable World. Creatable World was recently launched as the first gender-neutral doll. Connected to pop culture conversation, this is the first doll and the first play pattern that really recognizes that whether you're a boy, a girl, whatever you may be, however you may feel, you can play and have a play item that inspires you to be and do whatever you want to do and whoever you want to be. Just take a quick look at the look and feel of this new brand.
In our world, dolls are as limitless as the kids who play with them. Introducing Creatable World, the first doll line designed to keep labels out and invite everyone in. Making play more inclusive than ever before. Creatable World. All welcome.
Pretty cool. Now, we're at the very beginnings of this project and brand, but clearly recognized, and actually, ironically, today, and standing in front of an inventor community, it's pretty coincidental, we were announced as one of the 100 best inventions from Time Magazine. So again, a toy, a concept related to pop culture, brought to the market and recognized by industry leaders as one of the best inventions this year. So all inventions and relationships that we say have some connection to pop culture. But our history is, of course, part of what we need to study, as I said, to understand how to move forward. And this is a really important phrase that is part of our history. And many of you know this line and probably know this song. And we used to obviously say, life in plastic, it's fantastic. I mean, it's part of the Barbie heritage. Today, not so much. Right? So here we are. Now you start to think, oh boy, right? How do I start to reinvent? This is a pop culture conversation. You saw those climate marches. You know what's happening in the world. This is a real conversation in real time. And we are a real brand with a real company with real heritage that called it out as fantastic. So if you're in the context of how do you reinvent to stay relevant, you really do need to address this. And we are addressing it. Sustainability is the next frontier for purpose at Mattel. And we need help. We need you to think about that in the context of what you invent. Again, not only in pop culture, but part of the pop culture conversation, because it's the right thing to do, and it's also going to be how people vote with their dollars, is around sustainability. We are making progress in sustainability with plant-based plastics that help reduce waste, and you're going to hear a lot more conversations, and I do believe in the industry, particularly with the big industry leaders, a lot more conversations around sustainability. And so understanding that in the context of how you think, I believe, is also a really important part. So we're not just inventing toys and reinventing play. We're actually reinventing the company at the very same time. It's a 75-year-old storied company. I told you and shared with you our founders in the original TV days bet the farm on TV before they even knew what it was going to be. And we continue to have that as part of our DNA. The digital dialogue that exists today is way different than what was commercial marketing back then. And today we're the number one in toys on YouTube and Facebook. Mattel owns 9 of the top 15 YouTube brands for kids. We are prominently in that space, and to be relevant today, you need to be where your consumers are, and that's where they are. We are also driving content to commerce with 22 new television shows, episodic series in production. We are engaging in storytelling that ultimately drives merchandising across multiple categories, and we are in the movie business. We have 8 announced movies that are actually in production right now on some of our key brands, some that you know, and that are working today, and some that are being reinvented again through storytelling. I mean, Magic 8-Ball, Viewmaster, even Barney. Love him, don't love him, he's coming back on the big screen. And we're working with incredible talent as well. Part of the identity of Mattel is around the creators that create the creations. whether those are toy inventors, marketers, designers, various different people that work in the company, and the partners that we work with. And so when we tell our stories around our brands, we work with the best of the best. Tom Hanks is going to be doing Major Matt Mason. Margot Robbie and a variety of other well-known figures in the industry are going to be doing the Barbie movie. Many, many other parts. But at the core, at the center, at the everything, at the origin of the company, product is hero. That is what moves the company along. The stories we tell, the movies we make, the content we create, it's all driven to ultimately drive product and product sales. And we're very, very proud to say that Hot Wheels is the number one selling toy in the world today. We are also very proud to continue to say that Barbie is the number one fashion doll today. These are brands that continuously get reinvented, but the foundation and original premise of them was what made them great. We also currently have 12 toys, toy nominations in the Toadies, which is more than any other company. So Invention is alive and well at Mattel. We believe in it, we need it, product is hero, and we're driving success around ultimately what's most important in the context of the company. And so as I look upon this audience and as I represent Mattel in the context of what you all do and who we are a legendary company. We have amazing legendary brands, a list of IP 400 long. There's the opportunity to take existing IP and think about it, to reinvent it for today. You can see the background of this one. Anybody know who? He-Man, Skeletor, Masters of the Universe, big property in the 80s, coming back strong with a movie and a lot of other merchandising. But thinking about brands like this, in addition to inventing entirely new brands. The origins of the company was built in a garage. We have a garage mindset that we're trying to infuse every day. Yes, we are a big company, but we just work in a much bigger garage. The truth is, it's still the same gig. It's invention, it's design, it's risk-taking. It's taking that chance. It's bringing it to market in new and different ways. It is a machine, and you can get into the machine. It's hard. Nothing's easy. 80% of it is showing up. Here I am. I'm here for a reason. I'm here engaging in this community because this is the origin of our company. The pipeline to continue another 75 years is my responsibility. So when I study the company's origins, no matter how complicated and how dramatic, and by the way, the world loves talking about Mattel, at the core, it's a house of invention. At the core, it's a house of creativity. At the core, it's just a big garage. So get in there, push hard, get with our people, make that sizzle, show me, show them, invent. That's what's going to make Mattel last. That's what's going to get you and your idea on the cover of Time Magazine. And it is absolutely all possible. So work hard, leverage the advantage you have in this community with each other and with the people that are here today. And thank you so much for your time, and I'm looking forward to hopefully meeting many of you.